They're coming down to the 16th pole. Catholic Boy is pulling away. He's so impressive today, the others didn't even have a prayer. Catholic Boy rolls in the run. Happy Travers.
Live from the backstretch at historic Saratoga Race Course, this is Racing Across America with Seth Merrow. Race the Leah Auto Group. To search their inventory, schedule a service appointment, or find a dealership near you, visit leahcars.com. Leah Cars for life.
Welcome to the Thursday edition of Racing Across America. Seth Merrow live from our Clare Court set. You can see the horses working out behind me on what looks to be a nice Saratoga morning after yesterday, which was a little damp and a little cool. It's dried out today, but with the weather we had, the turf racing is still on the sidelines on a hold for today. And I would think things will turn around over the last 4 days of the meet, and we'll be back on the grass Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and Monday, just looking at the weather. But again, we had a pretty good soaking early yesterday. Today, though, as I say, other than the fact that we got soaked yesterday, it looks like it's going to be a nice day today. It's maybe a little bit overcast right now, but I think the sun's supposed to pop out, lower humidity, mid-70s. So it should be a good day of racing up here at Saratoga on this Thursday afternoon. Thursday morning, a little bit later on in the program, one of our Gary Contessa interviews. He talked to Ken McPeek, of course, Swiss Skydiver coming up tomorrow in the Kentucky Oaks. So the Ken McPeek interview towards the end of the program. Thursday morning means a visit from the Daily Racing Form Boys. And today it's Dave Grening, and we'll talk a little bit about some of the stakes action coming up here at Saratoga on Saturday. The Woodward among the highlights of Saturday's card, but a great stakes card coming up on Saturday here. And we'll also maybe get some thoughts from Dave on the Oaks and the Derby as well. Top of the show, however, I wanted to get her on the show for a few weeks now. She was in town for quite a bit of the summer, never caught up to her then, although, given the situation this year, probably would have had to have her via Zoom, regardless of whether she was around the corner or back home in Lexington where she is. It's Annise Mtplaisir, who we've had on the program in the past. She, of course, had worked a couple seasons for Sean and Joe Clancy and Tom Law's Saratoga Special. But subsequently went to the Goldolphin Flying Start Program. I'd like to hear a little bit about that. And also has started up a new initiative, Amplify Horse Racing, which is going to pull young people into the industry. And so I wanted to get a little info on that as well. And for folks who might be interested, we'll point you in that direction. But Annise, good morning.
Good morning, Seth. Thank you so much for having me on. I'm glad that we could finally coordinate, even though it ended up being in a different state.
Yeah, it's as I say, I wanted to have you on because we had you on a couple of times in the past, so people may be familiar with you and in that Saratoga Special pipeline moving into the industry. And I wanted to, as I say, talk a little bit about Amplify. But before we do that, I want to talk a little bit about the Flying Start program, Goldolphin Flying Start. And for folks who aren't familiar, it's an initiative that gets young people into the industry in a big way with kind of a two-year program where travel all around the world and hit all portions of the industry. That's my quick overview, but you tell us what it was like personally for the last couple of years.
So I just graduated from Goldolphin Flying Start on July 1st, and I started the program in 2018. So it is a two-year international thoroughbred industry management course, and they select 12 trainees each year, and you travel to 5 different countries. So you start in Ireland, and then you move on to England, the US, Australia, Dubai, and then in a typical year, you would return to Ireland again for the graduation, and we all know that it has not been a typical year. So we were actually sent home from Dubai, and we finished the course remotely. And so it was a bit sad because nobody on my program got to say a goodbye. We left Dubai very promptly, and we all thought that we would have a chance to reunite again in Ireland for the graduation, which didn't happen, but it made for a very, you know, unique experience. But it's, you know, the program itself, I'm so thankful to have had the opportunity to go through, because every country, even though, you know, the ultimate goal is, you know, getting, you know, breeding horses, getting them to the track. You know, we learned a lot about aftercare as well, but every country has a slightly different way of going about it. And Australia was particularly fascinating in the way that, you know, their breeding program works and the way horses are foaled and how popular the racing program is. But I'm so thankful to have had those 2 years.
Yeah, we're showing you a photo of your class, I believe, at the Kentucky Derby last year, 12. And obviously a class of 12, it's very selective. Talk about the process of applying and getting accepted.
So they really encourage you to have as well-rounded of a background as possible. So if you have an interest in the industry, to gain as many different internship and work experiences as you can before you apply to the program, because when you get in, you're trained in various aspects, from, you know, breeding to foaling, training. As I said, we learn a lot about aftercare. And so I did a lot of internships beforehand. And then it's a general application. You have to have lots of references. At one point, you do have to do a video of sorts answering various questions, might be how you would handle different scenarios. And then you go through an interview portion, you give a presentation. So there are lots of different phases almost to the application process, but it's well worth it. And even, you know, if somebody doesn't get in when they apply the first time, we always encourage people to apply again. One of the girls on my program actually applied 3 times before she got in. And, you know, even the application process is a fantastic learning experience, and they give you feedback on how you can continue to round out your resume. So it is an intense experience, but I always recommend people to apply. And if you don't get in, you know, don't lose heart. Just keep applying again, because the program is well worth it.
Would I be right? It sounds like, in describing it as an analogy, horse racing graduate school.
Yeah, and that's generally how I have to explain it to people. So, you know, whenever we'd have, say, a break from the course, and I would go home and have to go to the dentist, and people ask you, so what do you do? And I have to explain, well, I'm kind of going through this international horse racing master's degree course. And people are so fascinated by that, that you can have a program that, you know, you get to travel and you learn about, you know, marketing and communications and the business aspect and the horsemanship aspect. But that is, it is a good way, a very basic analogy of, you know, to help people understand it.
And how exciting was it when you got the word you'd been accepted?
Yeah, okay, so this is kind of funny. When I was accepted, I was working on the Kentucky Derby Notes team in 2018 for Churchill Downs. And so I had been to the track that morning, and my trainer that I was, you know, following around and I had to interview was Mark Cassie. And so I'd done all my interviews and finished my writing. And I had just pulled into the parking lot of the hotel I was staying at and parked my car and turned off the ignition. And my phone started buzzing, and it said, maybe Clota Kavanagh, who's the director of the Godolphin Flying Start Program, informing me that I had been accepted. And I was so excited. I was floating on cloud 9. So it's interesting that now I've just recently graduated, and I'm actually in Louisville at the moment, covering the Derby right now. So I was at Churchill Downs this morning. So just everything comes full circle in life.
That's very good. That's very true. And you know, you've talked about the international experience. Again, hit on some of the countries you visited and how that played into the whole program. You've talked a little bit about people do things differently in different countries, but explain a little bit about some of the locations you were at and, again, how that played into the whole two-year program.
We started in Ireland, and we were based at Kildangan Stud, which is the Godolphin operation there. And that's where they have their stallions, and they have several different operations actually in Ireland, but that's where we were based, and they have yearlings there. And so right away we were thrown into breaking yearlings, which was really cool to get the feel for their process. And on Kildangan Stud, they have various barn areas called yards. And so they'd have the yearlings divided into different yards, and then they would have, you know, a round pen in each of those yards. And so right away we learned about ground driving and the foundation that they put on their yearlings before they're allocated to the different Godolphin trainers. And then we went on to Newmarket in the UK. And so we got to experience, you know, I had always experienced training on a dirt track and then, you know, once or twice a week going to watch turf works. And everything is on these amazing grass tracks. They had a couple all-weather tracks and they're called gallops. And so it was really incredible to get a feel for how training can be so different, and that a trainer might have a yard on, you know, one side of Newmarket and might have to walk their entire set of horses, you know, 20 minutes to get to a grass gallop on the other side and then walk them all the way back. So it's just a very tranquil, you know, feels very natural way of training horses. Now, I loved being in the U.S. because, you know, there's kind of a comfort level of being back in your own country and having that level of familiarity with how everything works. And I would say Australia was the most fascinating phase for me, mostly because I didn't have that much breeding experience coming into the course. And so most countries would foal mares in a barn, you know, they'd be very heavily monitored. And in Australia, everything foals outside in a, you know, in a small paddock. So foal is born and right away they're out in the world. One of the farms that I was working at, when you'd move mares and foals from one paddock area to the other, you would actually essentially pony the mares off of a four-wheeler, or they called them quad bikes there. So it's just, it was so different, but absolutely amazing. You know, Dubai is very kind of extravagant, and Maidan was just massive and looked very much like, you know, the grandstands itself looked like a giant spaceship, and it all just felt so surreal at times where you'd feel like, you know, how did I get here? But very cool experiences.
And I'm assuming with the 12 people, your 12 classmates, I'm assuming that was an international class as well.
Yes. So we had four Americans on my course, four from the UK, two from Ireland, one Australian girl, and one French girl. So it was a very diverse class. And, you know, every class is slightly different. The class below us has a young man from Japan and a young lady from Argentina. And so it's really cool to, you know, meet people and learn what their experiences were and what they would consider, you know, normal for breeding and raising and training racehorses, and being able to compare your experiences and share ideas and really develop a really unique, you know, friendship with them because you're living so closely, but, you know, you're developing very close business relationships essentially for the rest of your life as well. They're living so closely for 2 years and you learn how everyone works, and it was cool.
Yeah, and I wanted to bring you on to talk a little bit about the Godolphin Flying Start, because I'm sure some people are familiar, maybe some people aren't. Up here at Saratoga, I know a lot of people get pulled into the game, and a lot of young people may be thinking about the horse racing industry as a potential kind of place to go for a career, and Godolphin Flying Start is one of those spots to maybe think about. It is the elite side. Congratulations to you for getting in and graduating. And if folks go and examine, you'll find a lot of Flying Start graduates have gone out into the industry subsequently. And we said you were in the pipeline in the Saratoga Special, which has produced a lot of industry players when we had you in here a couple of years ago. So really happy to see as you progressed. But if folks are thinking about the industry, you have also started your own new initiative. And I wanted to talk a little bit about that, because that is a great way, I think, for people to learn more about what's out there in the industry if they're thinking about a career in horse racing, and maybe connect with people. So talk a little bit about the new organization. The website is amplifyhorseracing.org to find more information. But tell us about Amplify.
Amplify was co-founded by myself and then my friend Madison Scott, who's also a Godolphin Flying Start graduate. And it kind of came together because we both had these very roundabout pathways of getting into the industry. I'm originally from the area near Fargo, North Dakota. She was originally from Austin, Texas. We both, you know, saw horse racing on TV at one point and then just kind of set about making contacts and finding internships and trying to gain as much experience and knowledge as we could. And actually, I was very fortunate because I learned about Goldolphin Flying Start when I was still very, very new to the industry, just shortly after I became interested in horse racing. And it was kind of the first educational program in the industry that I learned about. And so I thought, oh, wow, you know, that's really cool. That is for me, and that's going to be my goal. So that's what drove me. But Madison and I both had this, you know, previous interest in education and making that pathway a bit easier to get youth involved, because we have all of these incredible programs and organizations and initiatives in the industry, but in the US it's all very spread out. And so we wanted to come up with step one for getting into the industry, and that was Amplify Horse Racing. And the goal is for this to be a collaborative platform that celebrates and promotes the positive work in progress, all of these amazing educational programs, and essentially amplifies them. So on the website, we have it categorized into different aspects where somebody who's entirely new to the thoroughbred industry could come to the website, learn, well, what is thoroughbred racing? What are the different educational and technical training programs? What are some different career options? Because that's another thing. A lot of people, you know, from the outside looking in, you think, well, career-wise, I can either be a jockey or a trainer or a veterinarian. And we wanted to showcase all of these different segments of careers. So we've enacted, to this point, several different pilot projects, giving educational tours and having some enhanced engagement with existing organizations. And then we had lots of grand plans for this year, as everybody does, and had to pivot a little bit. And I actually have to say I'm really thankful for that, because when you tap into virtual education as we have, it improves the increases the accessibility of racing even more, because it doesn't matter if you're a kid in North Dakota, Iowa, Texas, wherever you're coming from. So each month we've been hosting what we call horse racing hangouts, where every month is focused on a different category of careers in the industry, from marketing and communications to hands-on work with horses. Our upcoming, no, it is September now, so in September, our next one is going to be on careers in benevolence in the industry. And so, you know, anyone who wants to tune in is invited into this conversation with industry professionals to talk about their own career and educational journeys and how they became involved. And then, you know, people can also ask questions as to how they can start to navigate their own journey. And so that's, you know, been a very cool way of tapping into virtual education.
Annise, we got to wrap it up, but I wanted, as I say, bring you on to introduce people who may not be familiar to the Flying Start program. And you're a great example of a person who kind of had an interest in the industry, got involved, and then moved into that and have now graduated. And that's a great little check mark on your resume. But your new initiative here, I think, will get some people who otherwise. And you make a great point. I have talked to people over the years. I think a lot of people think horse racing, yeah, jockey, trainer, veterinary. Yeah. But there's media and there's financial, and all of that makes the racetrack run or the racing organizations. And your website points out a lot of those different options for people to think about. The virtual hangouts look like they're very interesting and a good way for people to learn more as well. So I'll tell people once again, go to amplifyhorseracing.org. And I congratulate you for coming up with the idea and wanted to introduce people to that. But Annise, really happy to see that you're progressing along the trail and got through the Flying Start program and now are moving on. Good to hear you're down at Churchill doing a little derby work as well. And we will check in again as the future progresses.
Great. Thank you so much, Seth. Good luck with the rest of the meet.
Appreciate it. Annise Mtplaisir, again, amplifyhorseracing.org. If you or you know somebody who is maybe thinking, hey, yeah, I kind of like to get in the horse racing industry, and what are my options and whatnot, that's a great starting point to branch out from, so keep it in mind. All right, we'll take a break. He is here, Dave Grening from the Daily Racing Farm. We'll talk a little Saturday stakes action and more. Stay tuned. No track, no problem. There's no better place to follow the Saratoga race meet than Capital OTB and OTB TV. With our live TV shows from the Saratoga Backstretch and our live remotes, all the information you need is right here. Each and every day of the Saratoga meet, we talk with all the top trainers, jockeys, handicappers, and racing personalities. So stay with Capital OTB and OTB TV this racing season and win more. Welcome back to Racing Across America on a Thursday morning. Thursday morning means a visit from the Daily Racing Forum, and today, the last visit from our friend Dave Grening. Dave, good morning.
Seth, how are you?
Very good. Why don't we, since it is the last visit, why don't you just give some thoughts on the meet overall before we get into some of the other action. To me, I was thinking about it as I was driving in this morning. I think, you know, obviously it's been very different, but up until maybe the last week or so, the weather was great, the racing has been great, the stars you would want to show up did, most of them lived up to their billing. Obviously the weird part was no fans, and hopefully next year that changes, but overall I thought the meet was pretty good. I mean, the protocols held up, and we've raced the whole time.
Yeah, we haven't had too many issues except with the weather the last week or so, and I thought it's run pretty smoothly, and yes, it's still, as what's day 35, I still have a weird feeling walking down the steps to go interview the post-race stakes and go past empty seats. And, I thought I would have got used to it by now, but I haven't. I'll tell you one thing, an odd thing that has stood out to me at the meet, which I think is a good thing, is how many days there have been where each race was won by a separate trainer. It could go through a whole meet without a day.
Oh, I didn't notice that.
I came across six consecutive cards that were won by, each race was won by a different trainer. Then we had a double up, and then we had like a card or two again that each day was won by. I think we probably had more trainers win races at this meet than maybe in past years. I hadn't done the exact math, but it just seems interesting on how, you know, some smaller outfits have had good meets, and that's good to see. And even, you know, it's kind of fun to see the trainer's title not decided yet. I mean, Todd's, I think, one in front with 5 days left to go, and I think today's off the turf scenario probably works against Chad, because I know he had some horses that were live in the grass races. So it's going to be a fun little battle there. But even beyond the top two and the regulars that we see all the time, we've seen a lot of different trainers win, and it's kind of good to see, spread the wealth, especially
the one,
at this time.
The one that jumps out, it jumps out to me, particularly because sitting here in the morning, he drives by every morning. Jim Bond has had a great meet.
Bond's had a terrific meet. In fact, he won another one yesterday. you know, Ray Handel's had a great meet. Orlando Notice had a great meet. You know, just a lot of guys have had won some races here, and it's good to see. Spread, you know, like I said, spread the wealth out, and this year, perhaps more importantly than ever, to see that happen.
Yeah, it was. You're right. It was fun, and I didn't realize the days where, because that is pretty unusual up here, where you have two or three powerhouses that you would expect.
And they're winning two or three a day, and that's not been the case.
Yeah. Before we get to this weekend, just want to go back and get some thoughts on last weekend. To me, the two dirt races stood out. Nothing against Channel Maker on the front end. That was a nice performance. Bye-bye, Melvin, for Grand Motion gets up to get the Saranac. But I thought Yopan, and particularly Win-Win-Win with that effort in the Florco coming from out of the clouds, those two kind of stood out to me.
That was an incredible performance from Win-Win-Win. You know, he's not even in the picture. At some point, you're watching, you're thinking, wow, he's going to be easy. He must not like the slop, and something's gone.
And it sounded like Mike Trombetta thought. Yeah. He's kind of like, I didn't see that coming.
Yeah, something's gone amiss. And then it's not like he's saving ground, cutting the corner, and rallying through the fence. He's going, you know, 18 wide and still. And I actually think, I mean, I looked up, coming, turn over home, and I'm seeing him gearing up to set his team. I said, that horse is going to win this race. And I'm like, you know, and then I'm like, maybe not. And then he's just kicked it in the last 70 yards. And wow, that was such a wonderful performance from that horse. And, you know, if you go back to last year, I know he was on the Triple Crown Trail and he ran maybe his best race a mile on the turf. But, you know, earlier in the year, as a 3-year-old, he set track record at Tampa for 7/8 in the Pasco. So maybe, you know, 7/8 to a mile, you know, I could see him being a Cigar Mile type of horse if they decide to go down that path.
Yeah, it seems like they've kind of now found his niche, as it were.
And then Yaupon, I mean, just another in a factory of sprinters that we saw another one emerge yesterday with Nashville for Steve Asmussen. It's amazing what he's got in that barn for that division. He just has fast horses. Yeah. If you're a trainer, you want to acquire fast horses, Steve Asmussen has acquired the fastest horses.
I'm glad you brought up Nashville.
And he was terrific.
On the non-stakes side, Cantata was a horse on non-stakes kind of debut efforts, but Nashville yesterday was, the early fractions and then kind of geared down late, but nobody was close.
Right. No, he was terrific yesterday, and Yao Pan was terrific in the race in the other day, and who knows where they go. Volatile, and he still got Volatile just kind of galloping around the Oklahoma training track waiting for the Vosburgh.
So again, it was a nice weekend, and as you say, yesterday Nashville was worth paying a little bit of attention to too. If people didn't see it, pull up the replay of that one. All right, let's take a look at Saturday stakes races, and as I said yesterday, maybe relish in it a little bit, that the difference this year, you'll be able to have the institutional memory to tell people you were there in some fashion for the year that the Kentucky Derby was run the same weekend as the Woodward at Saratoga.
And the Jim Dandy.
Exactly. So, knock wood, it never happens again. But a unique situation. Let's work our way back stakes-wise from the Woodward. I pulled up the Suburban, the obvious race to take a look at, because Tacitus got it done. Got it done pretty nicely that day as the favorite. Tacitus will be the number one horse in here. Moretti runs second. He's also back on Saturday. Math Wizard gets turned around quickly after the disappointment down at Charlestown just over a week ago. Spinoff comes up off the win in the Aladar for Todd Pletcher. That's a horse I liked earlier in the career, starting with that optional claiming win down at Tampa in February of last year. Didn't quite live up to that, but Jim Bond has prioritized. Global Campaign comes off a triple-digit win. I mean, it's a field of six, and folks, I think, will tilt towards Tacitus off this performance, but I think it's an intriguing field of a half dozen.
I kind of agree with you, Seth. Tacitus will be a deserving favorite, and if he wins, you know, no one's going to be surprised. Maybe that was the breakthrough performance that they've all been waiting for. You know, we kind of disappointed in a couple of spots last year up here in the Travers, and they've tinkered without blinkers, he's been well traveled. He went to Saudi and in Dubai, and they didn't run that race. He came back and went to Oaklawn. That didn't work out. Got a bit of a freshening, and then he ran really well in the Suburban, and he's got another freshening. And, you know, the mile and a quarter, talk about finding a niche for win-win-win. This is what this horse wants to do, and they have a nice series of races at a mile and a quarter, obviously leading up to the Classic. But having, said that, Global Campaign is a horse I've always been interested in. I know that Stan Huff had him up here last year. He was very high on him, coming off the Peter Pan. You know, they were dealing with a foot issue all of last year, and I guess after the Jim Dandy, they kind of just said no mas and put him away and let the foot grow out. And he came back with a nice allowance win at Gulfstream. things, I'm not exactly sure what went awry in the blame at Churchill, the one-turn mile, but he came back with a pretty gutsy performance in the Monmouth Cup. And you know, I don't see a ton of speed in here. If he doesn't, if he's able to get to the front, and, you know, he showed some grit last time in holding off Math Wizard. Now, granted, Math Wizard didn't run very well in the Charlestown, and he's back in, as you mentioned, in this spot. But I don't know. I thought Global Campaign had a chance to upset. And, you know, the spinoff has run. His two best races are probably the mile and eighth races here. Allowance race last year, allowance race this year. If he is able to repeat that performance, he will be in the mix, no question. But you just wonder, can he repeat that performance?
Yeah, and I will remind people, if you're a Math Wizard fan, don't forget down at Charlestown, the mile and eighth is like six turns. So you might not have liked that.
And he only has, as Safi pointed out to me on the phone yesterday, he said, look, I only got beat two necks for third. So yeah. If it's third, it doesn't look as bad as it's fifth.
10th race tomorrow is the Prioress Grade 2 event. And while we talk about this one, I'm going to pull up the replay from the victory ride. Frank's Rocket will be the winner for Bill Mopp. This is a horse that has shown a lot of talent throughout the career. Eight exacta finishes and eight career starts. But again, there are alternatives. Kamari comes off a try over at Royal Ascot. That was pretty good. It comes in for Wesley Ward. Secondary Market, lightly raced for Chad and Klarovich. A couple of wins in the most recent starts, most recent one of those being last September, but the comeback effort this year was pretty good. And Center Isle, another lightly raced but potentially talented horse from Chad Brown. So again, another field where I think Frank Sraquette will take the action, but I think there are a couple of alternatives if you want to shop around a little bit.
Yeah, you know, the horse that I thought ran really well in this in that spot, the race that you just showed, was Reagan's Edge for Cherie DeVoe. Hadn't really anticipated her being in the fray that early. Thought she would be more, you know, coming from
right
off the
there.
Pace. Yeah, she's second to the three horse, a little bit on the smaller side when compared to those other two. But, you know, if she goes back, now she's drawn on the outside, and it looks like there's some speed in here. So I was thinking that if she, you know, if she can sit the stalking trip that she did when she won the off-the-turf race at Churchill, she could be a little bit dangerous at a price. She was 13-1 then. Obviously, she'll be shorter because of how well she ran here. But I thought that was a pretty gutsy effort. And, you know, the fact that she's coming back here in this spot says a lot. And if you sort of don't, if you want to go maybe a different way, if you're not thrilled with this race and don't want any of the ones out of the victory ride, maybe Secondary Market jumping into Stakes Company for the first time. I know they were high on her last year. I think they were looking at the Frisette after she broke her maiden at Belmont, and then she had a problem. They got over that. She came out with a nice performance up here in an allowance race. And now she's got to step it up because she's taking on Stakes Company. But, you know, if she lives into the promise that they thought they had her, you know, that they thought of her last year, she could be dangerous. And it'll be interesting to see it's going to be interesting to see how they bet this race.
I was going to say the same thing. I'm going to be interested to see how Kamari goes. I said Frank's Rocket will take the action. Won't surprise me if Kamari gets.
Well, Kamari smoked her in the, in the Purple Mountain. I mean, if you look at Kamari, Kamari's been on turf. She's been on dirt. She's been successful on both surfaces. As you mentioned earlier, her last race was in Royal Ascot, where she was second on the turf in a Group One, and now she's coming into a Group Two on the dirt, which she's she's 2-for-2 on dirt. So she's I don't love the rail.
The morning line. So
yeah, I don't have it either. I don't love the rail for her, but she did win. You know, she's actually she did win the Purple Mountain from the rail, but she came from off the pace.
So again, another fun race coming up on Saturday. A little bit earlier, yes. On Derby Day, it's Jim Tandy, a Grade 2 event for the three-year-olds, $150,000 up for grabs. I pulled up the Belmont. Tis the Law is going to be the winner in here, but running a pretty good second, I thought. Dr. Post, Todd Pletcher, I think, was considering the Derby with this one, elected to go to the Jim Tandy. To me, maybe a little bit of an edge for that one, given what we saw behind Tis the Law. Now, last time was in the Haskell and ran third Beyond Authentic in New York Traffic. But to me, this is maybe more indicative of the talent. Happy Saver, though, comes in also for Todd. 2-for-2 in the career, so lightly raced, but I think has a little potential. And Live Your Beast Life, maybe a little bit interesting off the allowance event at the Mile and a Trip last time as well. What are your thoughts on the Jim Dandy?
Well, the first thing I'll say is that Happy Saver is probably going to scratch and go to the Federico Tessio on Monday. I think this was sort of an insurance policy, if you will, in case something happened to Dr. Post. But I think, you know, Todd splitting up his three-year-olds, Money Moves went to the Derby, and Dr. Post has always been earmarked for this spot, with Happy Saver likely to go to the Tessio. And by the way, for whatever it's worth, I think Happy Saver might turn out to be the best of the three when it's all said and done. This was a solid effort, obviously, to Tis the Law. Dr. Post should be a short price in here, and I don't see him getting beat, to be honest with you. you know, you could have made a case that he could have went to the Derby. They decided not to. The Haskell was kind of a disaster from a trip standpoint. I don't think he got anywhere close to the trip that Todd Pletcher was thinking he was going to get. It was kind of frustrating, too, because Todd was really debating whether to run here against Tizzalaw at a mile and a quarter or try Authentic at a mile and an eighth. And the horse was training very well leading up to that race, and he just didn't get the trip that they had envisioned. So he's continued to train well, you know, with Happy Saver here. I think he's, you know, going to be very tough to beat in this spot. The other horse that I'm a little bit interested in is Mystic Guide. He was the favorite in the Peter Pan. He didn't run the great that day. He was well off the pace. They're putting blinkers on him. They've been training him in blinkers to try and get him a little bit closer, and they've been working him behind horses to take the dirt a little bit better. So if he's shown that improvement, then he could be right there. But I still think they have a way to go to get to Dr. Post. And it would be interesting if the Belmont Stakes proved to be a key race for September 5th. Key prep race for September.
For the Jim Dandy on September 5th.
And the Derby.
And the Derby as well. And finally, the Glens Falls a little bit earlier in the card, and I would expect with the weather forecast the way it is, it will stick on the turf at a mile and three-eighths, grade two event. I pulled up the Weya from earlier in the meet, number four, My Sister Nat was the winner that day for Chad Brown and company. Complicit is maybe a little bit interesting to me, a horse that had been in the barn of Chad Brown earlier in the career, but I think has some talent. Civil Union off the two wins most recently, also potentially interesting for Shug. Lovely Lucky comes out of a win here earlier in the meet. Cross-entered, though, on...
Well, cross-enter today. There's two horses in this race that'll probably run in this race now because Lovely Lucky and Palace Athene were injured and two other than on the turf, but that came off. So kudos to the racing office for, you know, telling those guys, hey, you know, you may want to look at this spot so that they do have a place to run. So that that'll bulk the field up anyway from from 5 to 7, which is good. Look, you're showing My Sister Nat, who's the four horse here, is going to get up. My Sister Nat's probably had a little bit more to do in her two starts this year than they would probably like. She hasn't gotten off very well from the gates in those two races, but she did overcome it this time to win this race. And then her first start of the year, which was off an extended layoff, was against Me Mary, who's riding, who, you know, had a four race winning streak snap when she just narrowly lost to Rushing Fall in the Diana. So I think, you know, My Sister Nat's gonna be tough. I liked Civil Union's race in the River Memories. This is a step up. I think she's going to have to improve, but if she's, you know, it looked like she improved from her first win, from her allowance win in June to her River Memories victory in July. If she takes that another step forward for Shug, she could be right there too. I really basically have it down to My Sister Nat and Civil Union. I think My Sister Nat's though not going to really be able to afford a slow start again like she had in these two starts.
Sharp slow start last time, pinch start two back, and you start to think if they start to string them together, they may be prone to something. But I don't know whether
and a little shorter distance here to make overcome it.
And just before you go, wanted some thoughts, maybe the Oaks and the Derby, the Oaks is really highly anticipated. And I've been saying for a couple of weeks now, you just don't get this in the 21st century where a couple of horses have performances a week apart that put them that close in their division, Gamine and Swiss Skydiver. And then 3 weeks later, they face off to kind of decide it. So I think we're all really looking forward to Friday's Oaks and that matchup. But people are also mentioning Speech as a, you know, possible upset, or if these two kind of ding-dong it maybe at some point in the race and allow somebody else to pick up the pieces.
I mean, I guess that could be proven wrong tomorrow, and I think it means a freak. I just think she can do anything and do whatever they want her to do, and she should get better with racing. This was going to be, her fifth start, maybe?
Yeah.
Everyone's going to say, well, what about the two turns? What about the mile and eighth? She did finish first in an allowance race at Oaklawn around two turns. It was a mile and 16th. So I don't have an issue there.
Over speech.
And it was and the race was slightly faster than, I guess, the Fantasy, which Swiss Skydiver won the next day for whatever that's worth. I just think she's a freak. And whatever they want to do with her, go to the front, sit off another horse, moonwalk, whatever it is. I just think she's that talented, and, you know, tomorrow's a coming out. If you didn't think the Acorn was a coming out party, tomorrow's the prom, I guess. I mean, I just think she's. I hope we get to see her next year and come up here and run in races like the Coaching Club and you know, whatever. I'm hoping to be proven right, and I'm just going to be looking forward to watching it some more.
Yeah, it's as I say, highly anticipated, a fun race. And what adds to it also is they're both coming off big performances up here in the test and the Alabama. And that's kind of a throwback. I mean, when I first got into the game, the test was kind of a prep for the Alabama. Now they're two separate divisions, kind of. And you don't see that too
much. Right. I was say, was Alan Jerkins back? Because that's what it answered Alan with.
Yeah, exactly.
But that's how the confidence that Bob is to shorten her up and then stretch her out again. I mean, he's not doing that if he has questions. I think he knows what he has. I think Johnny knows what's underneath him, and it'll be fun to watch tomorrow.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to that. And the Derby, I mean, I think everybody in our audience, well, most everybody, some people are probably on the betting side looking for a little bit of an upset, but 'tis the law on the Saratoga folks. Just, you know, you don't come into a Derby normally. This year is different, obviously. You don't come into a Derby normally with that mile and a quarter question answered. He answered it with an exclamation point in the Traverse. It seems like the training he's holding up, so he seems to have this field over a barrel, I think.
Yeah, the only question he has to answer for me, because he just hasn't done it yet, is running back on relatively short rest. I mean, in 4 weeks, I don't want to say short, but he hasn't done it. Until you do it, you have to do it. So all his races have been well spaced out, whether it's whatever the reasons are, whether it's for the COVID, for however it all worked out. And that's the only thing. And he's coming. Like, if you're a handicapper, you're looking at a horse running back in 4 weeks off a career best, you think, well, he's going to bounce. And this isn't the type of field you want to bounce against.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not a terrible field. I mean, Honor AP is the reverse. Honor AP sort of ran a subpar race as the quote-unquote prep. I don't think John Sheriffs or the owners cared if he won the Shared Belief. And nobody will remember if he lost the Shared Belief if he wins the Kentucky Derby. And I think that's a serious horse who wants every bit of the mile and a quarter, who's trained by as good a horseman as Barkley Tagg is. John Sheriffs is, they're both old school guys who are, it's a kind of a classic matchup. And I think it's going to be fun. And they're lined up right next to each other in the starting gate. It's going to be fun. I'm rooting for 'Tis the Law. I'd like to see it happen for the connections, for the breeding program, for upstate area. But I don't know if it's the 3-5 is like, wow, really? They didn't run the race.
With 18 horses.
Yeah. And so he's trained magnificently up here. There are no flaws. There are no knocks on him. Just the one question about whether he can run that race back 4 weeks. Since something he hasn't done before.
You're right, that is legitimate. Another horse I have in my mix, Money Moves, the Pletcher horse lately racing. That's the one he elected to send to the Derby. I thought he might be a little bit interesting at a price.
Yeah, I'm not there. I mean, I guess if Prioritize wins the Woodward an hour and a half before, maybe I'll change my mind. But I think it's biting off a lot more than he could chew. And, I'm not there. There's some other I'm sort of chalking it out on top and then threw a couple of bombers underneath. And I guess I could throw him in there if I would extended it. But, a horse like Enforceable and a horse like Attachment Rate, just horses that you don't necessarily think are that. They're just trained by guys who really focus in on these races and,
historically, you got to throw Dallas in there with winning a press.
Yeah, I guess. I think that gets overblown a little bit. But I'm focused on the top two, and it's kind of chalky, but. Looking forward to watching it. My 28-year Derby streak is over, but maybe we'll start another one next year.
Yeah, that you aren't alone in that. I'm sure everybody's going to have that on their race course resume, that missing 2020, regardless of what the racetrack is. And again, it's been different up here, but people have been able to follow it with your coverage in the Daily Racing Forum, the hard copy, or drf.com. We've been happy to have you and Mike Welch alternate in here on Thursdays. That's always fun. Mike last week said he's headed down to New York, so the workout reports will continue. Folks have been using those, and it's highly recommended to use those. A little extra handicapping information that continues for a while now, too.
Right, through the Belmont Fall Meet, and a lot of two-year-old races down there, too, so it's always some good stuff in there. We've had Mike Vesey down at Belmont on the weekends during the summer here, so to add to this report, and that should also have some more stuff for the Belmont Fall Meet, too.
Very good. Dave, again, really appreciate you and Mike stopping in during the meet. Enjoy the last 4 days. Travel home safe, and we'll continue to follow you in the racing form.
Appreciate it. Thanks for having me.
Dave Grening from the Daily Racing Forum. We'll take a break. When we come back, we'll plug in our Contessa interview. He's going to talk to Kenny McPeek. Stay tuned.
Where's the best place to find your favorite teams, your favorite food, daily drink specials, and wagering on live horse racing? Legends Field Sports Bar, 711 Central Avenue, Albany. Get your game on day or night with 75 flat-screen TVs, tournament-style pool tables, a private banquet room, and live horse racing. So if someone asks you, where's the best sports bar in the capital region, tell them, Legends Field Sports Bar, inside the Clubhouse Racebook, 711 Central Avenue, Albany.
No matter where in the world you are, the excitement of wagering on horse racing is just a click away. You'll get live streaming, past performances, race replays, our virtual tote board, analysis and selections from professional handicappers, a simple, safe, and secure wagering platform, and best of all, you get track prices. CapitalOTBBet.com. Bet any place, anytime at CapitalOTBBet.com. And be sure to download our new mobile app from the iTunes Store or Google Play.
Thank you. I think what you guys are doing is awesome.
You're doing a great job. Keep that game rolling.
Seth, you do a great job too. So thank you, and I appreciate you having me on, and I appreciate watching your show every day.
To be sitting here with trainer Kenny McPeek, who has Swiss Skydiver in the Alabama tomorrow, and actually has a big hand of two fillies, two very, very accomplished fillies in the Alabama. And today we're going to get a little insight into Kenny's life.
Kenny, you're basically a Kentucky trainer, but that would be very unfair to call you a Kentucky trainer because you've done a lot of damage in New York over the years as well. I mean, you came up here, you won the Travers. You won the Alabama. You're looking for another win in the Alabama this week with Swiss Skydiver. Tell us about Kenny McPeek growing up.
Yeah, easy enough. My grandmother lived directly in town from Keeneland when I was a boy. And it wasn't unusual for us to ride ponies after church. We would go to Keeneland regularly. My grandfather would take me to the races when I was a boy. I can remember going up to the $50 window with him. He was an executive with R.J. Reynolds, and I'd have to hold on to his tweed jacket coat, little flap, and while he made a wager because he didn't want to lose me in the crowd. And so being in and around horses and horse racing was just part of the neighborhood. And I learned how to read a pedigree when I was probably 10 or 11 years old. I was given the idea that, okay, if you look at the sire and the broodmare sire and all that stuff, I found all that interesting. And by the time I was 16, I got a hot walking job a small job working on a farm and around Lexington after I got my driver's license. Graduated from UK with a degree in business, and I always say that in 50 cents would get me a bad cup of coffee, but went to work on the racetrack the next morning, hot walking for Shug McGahey. It was just part of the routine. It's a beautiful area, and I feel fortunate to have grown up there.
Did you come up through the ranks with Shug? I mean, were you assistant trainer to him at some point?
Not at all. No, you know what? I worked for him for about 6 weeks during a fall Keeneland meet and a fall Churchill meet, and didn't really have any notion to become a horse trainer. It was just something that I enjoyed. And through a series of events, I actually tried to apply my degree to real life. And back in the mid-80s, there weren't many jobs to be had. So by the next summer, by the summer of 85, my father was partners on a few cheaper horses, nothing of any big value. And he called me one day and asked if I'd help him take care of them for a couple of weeks until he figured out how to sell these horses. So I said, well, sure, I'll help you in the mornings, but you'll have to do afternoons. So we rented some stalls and tried to sell the horses, couldn't sell the horses. And here I am 35 years later, and I'm still doing it.
Wow. Did you have a mentor? Would you say that, I mean, most of us have come up under another trainer, somebody that really taught us. Did you teach yourself, or did you have a mentor? Did somebody take you under their wing and mold you into what you are today?
Yeah, you know, the evolution of all that. Okay, so those three horses that we had, we actually had a trainer next to us, and they would run in his name. And I knew I didn't know anything, so I had to pay attention to a lot of different other trainers that were successful. I loved watching the good horses work and run. The guys that were influential for me were, and some may know these names, Bernie Flint's a close friend of mine even today. I just got off the phone with Wayne Lucas. We talked for half an hour because he's sick. And he's a guy that I've always looked up to and been fond of. You know, Ray Lawrence was somebody who trained the dam of Mr. Prospector and for Spendthrift Farm back in the 1970s and 80s. Those guys were probably a big influence. Carl Nasker is a close friend. I've always been able to lean on Carl if I had a question or wasn't sure exactly how to handle a horse. But otherwise, a lot of it's self-taught. You know, I trained a lot of average horses in the beginning, and I think you learn a lot of lessons, and I think you have to pay attention to each individual horse. You need to know who they're by and who they're out of and how that pedigree is going to transcend and what type of horse you're handling. And I still learn from every horse I get my hands on and try to understand what makes them tick and go with what's successful.
I pretty much felt that way as a trainer as well. I think not a day went by where I didn't learn something. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting that you mentioned Wayne Lucas. I spoke to him yesterday because, I mean, when something happens to Wayne, he's in all of our hearts. And, and I know he went through a really rough time. He told me, and he probably told you as well, that he wasn't sure he was going to make it. He was that sick with COVID.
Yeah, he said he had a couple bad days that he didn't know.
And Wayne, interesting that you bring up Wayne, because Wayne has always thought outside the box. And I've always been a big believer that in order to succeed, you have to be able to accept failure. And Kenny, I have seen you do things outside the box that people just don't do. You took Swiss Skydiver, and instead of going with playing the easy hand and going to the Ashland, you went to the Bluegrass and damn near pulled it off.
Yeah. Swiss Skydiver fighting on. Art Collector is right there. Art Collector ahead in front. A half length to the good. 16th pole. Art Collector, Brian Hernandez Jr. to win the Toyota Bluegrass. What an effort from Swiss Skydiver to be second.
You're a guy who takes chances. Tell me about your philosophy on that.
Tell me about that, because that's a really admirable trait.
Well, there's roots to that. And some people don't know all this. So when I was in 1996, I got a stomach ache one day. And I was at the Phasic Tipton yearling sale and working. And by that night, they had me in the hospital. By the next day, and I had been sick for a period. I had been having intestinal issues. But anyway, long story short, I've got a 8 or 10 inch incision where they did exploratory surgery. And I had had a misdiagnosed ruptured appendix that I had been living with for almost a year and a half. And the next morning, the doctor said, "Do you know how close you were from dying?" And I said, "No idea, tell me." She said, "Meh, 6 to 12 hours maximum and you're not here anymore." So I got off that operating table it took me about a month to get back to work. And I do things where life's a bit of a bonus, if you look at it that way. Because I lived through that and I realized that life isn't to be taken for granted, I tend to probably take more chances. I've never been scared to run a horse in a big race if a horse was doing well. I don't get too enamored with, I certainly don't care about my win percentages. I'm more worried about doing something fun and enjoying it. I thought it'd be really cool to win the Bluegrass with the filly, and I thought I could do it. I thought I had one horse to beat, and that's the way that worked. Taking horses to England, I'd like to have a division of horses in England one day. I think that's the roots of the industry. If the prize money were better, I'd probably already be there. But racing horses, it's just a big boys game, and we have fun, and you can't have any fear, and you know, horses don't know their odds, and they don't know their pedigree. And isn't that why we do it? To take chances and see if you can pull off something big.
So you're sitting back at Keeneland, and you're weighing Swiss Skydiver, Bluegrass, Ashland, Bluegrass, Ashland. Tell me what you're thinking. Tell me what you're thinking and making the decision ultimately for the Bluegrass. What was the determining factor?
Most other years it would have been a no-brainer, but I had the other filly on Vuitton, and you know, I bought her as a yearling as well, but I had, you know, Scott Leeds and Gonzalo Torrealba, good clients as well, and I really felt like her best chance to win a stake was going to be if I didn't run them against each other. So it was kind of a unique dynamic there. Any other year probably would have been a no-brainer. You'd go in the Ashland, or just run her in the Ashland. But the way that Speech ran, I might not have won the Ashland. But I don't know. I mean, it's the same. It's not black and white. This game's all gray. And I'd won a couple of bluegrasses already, and I was hoping to kind of stack those numbers.
Man, and I'll tell you, she came running. So she almost gave you that win.
That should
was
be
great.
A grade one.
Yeah,
it really should be.
Yeah, and do you use a number system? I mean, do you have? I mean, a lot of people. This business has become fairly computerized, fairly good technology out there. What is your system for saying I want to run in this race as opposed to that race?
You will be surprised. No, I don't. I'm a speed rating variant guy when it comes to reading the racing form. I like those numbers. I don't read the buyers so much, although I do think they're useful. I do know how to read the rags, and I do get the rags and numbers on a regular, the thoroughgraph and those sheets. And there are occasions when I want to put them all in front of myself and understand what I'm looking at. But you can't, it isn't a numbers game. You know, it's blood, blood and flesh, and, you know, you've got a horse that everything's got to come together, and you want a horse, especially in these big races. And I'll read the sheets more for the big races, but you've got to develop into it, and you've got to peak them at a certain point, and it's just not all numbers.
Recently, it's not even that recent, you're the only app in town, which is a horse racing app. Tell us about your app, because really, with all the horsemen out there, nobody else has come up with anything like this, and I think probably a major part of our business relies on your app on a daily basis. I do.
Are you a horse racing fan? Do you have a smartphone? If so, text the word horse to 84700 and get the coolest horse racing app ever.
Me and a buddy were having dinner one night in South Florida, and he was complaining that he couldn't follow my horses. He didn't know how to keep up with them. And they had already created the ESPN app at the time. And I asked the question, who's making a horse racing app? Is anybody making a horse racing app? There needs to be a horse racing app where you can follow like you do any other sport. And so I did a little research, and what started out is it looked like it was going to be maybe a $100,000 to $200,000 project has turned into I've got an excessive amount of money in it that I probably am never going to get back. But we grow. It continues to average 7,000 to 8,000 new users a month. And we have evolved into an advertising-based, premium-based model because we had to learn how to make money with it. And even then, we don't make much. But horse racing's got to figure out how to connect to the masses. And if we don't do that, we're going to continue to lose market share in the sports world. And we can't compete with baseball, basketball, football, hockey, unless we connect to the fans as opposed to them having to come to us. So that was the vision of it. We'd like to eventually one day be able to take wagers, but that's a whole nother conversation. And in the meantime, I hope people utilize it, and I hope it continues to grow the sport.
We really need to promote horse racing, and your app certainly does that. And you've won the Alabama already, correct?
Yeah.
And this will be your second go, and you got two rock solid horses in this. I mean, Swiss Skydiver's getting all the attention, but yeah, you have another filly that I've read is doing pretty good.
Yeah, you know, En Boutant's the other filly, and you know, this is a great race. We were going to be 8 weeks between her last race at Keeneland, the Bluegrass, and the Oaks, and you know what? She's been doing super. This is a filly that's Swiss Skydiver's pretty amazing. She eats like a colt. We ran her in the Bluegrass. You drop her feet in after she shipped over and back. She eats in an hour. She's a trainer's dream, to be honest. En Boutant, we've been prepping for this race, and we've been pointing towards it since spring. And she's doing super herself. And she's going to have to run the best race of her life. But that happens sometimes. And I think we've got her prepped to run big. But It's an exciting race. I mean, you don't turn your nose up to the Alabama, especially if you got a good horse for it.
You don't. It's a heck of a credential.
Yeah.
And I love it. And, you know, we're wishing you all the best in that race.
Thanks.
I think you have a great hand. You're playing a great hand. Kenny, thank you very much for this fantastic, insightful look into your life.
My pleasure, completely.
And we really appreciate you taking the time out of your day to spend a little time with us and our viewers. On behalf of Capital OTB and myself, we can't thank you enough for this time. This is Gary Contessa at Capital OTB with trainer Kenny McPeek.
Welcome back to Racing Across America on this Thursday morning. Just going to wrap things up with some promos and whatnot. Thanks to Gary Contessa again for his interview work. Ken McPeek out at the barn. So we thank Gary and Ken. Thank Dave Grening for swinging by today. Again, the last visit from the Daily Racing Forum guys, but you still have 4 days to keep up with their work here at Saratoga. And then the shift down to Belmont as well. Both Dave and Mike Welch appreciate their visits during the Saratoga season. And the top of the show, again, Annise Mtplaisir, who has started the amplifyhorseracing.org initiative that is meant to bring new people into the industry and introduce them into the game, but more importantly, the variety of positions that are available in the industry on racetracks or among racing organizations. I think a lot of people enjoy the racing game. Young people or people kind of thinking of a new career move. You enjoy the game, but you don't realize how diverse the possibilities are for employment. And so, again, amplifyhorseracing.org, I think, kind of spells out some of those opportunities that may be out there for you or someone you know who may be in that position. So pass on the info, Amplify Horse Racing. Today, there's a $100 online knockout challenge. Swing by the website for more information. There's also a $100 online late pick four bankroll with Mike Callahan. I'm not sure if the team has been totally selected or not. You can always find out more, though, by going to the website, capitalotb.com. Friday, $500 bounty bet. It got reset because somebody hit it last week for the entire bounty. You have the opportunity to do that this week by playing the late pick five at Saratoga tomorrow with your Capital OTB bet account. That's all you have to do, and you're in for all or part of that bounty. Friday, there's also a Saratoga track bonus to the top 50 highest wagering account holders. Get a little extra dough in your account, so keep that in mind. Saturday Syndicate, I'm virtually certain that team has already been selected, but when Mike stopped in, Mike Callahan yesterday, Handicapper's report, he noted that the Syndicate has been so popular, it will continue during the Belmont meet. So we will alert you as those openings come up. For $25, you get to jump in on a big $750 pick five ticket. There have been a couple of nice hits for the Syndicate up here at Saratoga this year. So again, there is a Syndicate on Saturday. I'm virtually certain that the team's been picked. You can check the website to make sure, but it will continue in the fall. Saturday, $500 OTV Live bankroll with Brian Addo. He will be live from Bailey's. Sully Crotty was down there last week. Nice crowd. Great spot to go if you want to watch the races and maybe get a little extra cash. If you have a Capital OTV bet account, swing on by and get your chance to be on the team Saturday. Bailey's with the $500 bankroll. Brian had a good bankroll out of Prime a couple of weeks ago. Bounced the $500 up to well over $1,000. So everybody in the team got some good dough. See if you can be part of that on Saturday down at Bailey's. Sunday, double promotion at the Clubhouse Racebook. Win a bet and a match bet. That happens Sunday. And we end the season with a Syndicate. And this one may still be open. Check the website for this. An Empire 6 Syndicate where, again, you chip in, but there's a big ticket put together. It's a mandatory payout, obviously, on the last day of the meet for the Empire 6 up here at Saratoga. So there's the Empire 6 Syndicate. Go to the website for more information there. Advanced wagering begins today on the Oaks and the Derby. Keep that in mind if you want to get a head start. Friday, tomorrow, Clubhouse Racebook opens at 9:30 with an early post time. There's early post times up here at Saratoga as well. Don't just get plugged in
Churchill, but earlier post times here at Saratoga than there has been over the past. Today we're normal, but starting tomorrow, things go a little bit earlier, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, up here at Saratoga as well. But with Kentucky Oaks having an early post time down at Churchill, clubhouse tomorrow opens at 9:30. All the other branches open at 10. On Saturday, with the early post time for the Derby card down at Churchill, the clubhouse will open at 9. All other branches open at 10 on Saturday. First folks going through the gate at the clubhouse racebook on Saturday, first 150 folks get a Kentucky Derby commemorative glass. There's also going to be some $10 signed Tis the Law prints. Nice-looking photo. And your $10 will go to the PDJF as a donation. So keep that in mind Saturday at the clubhouse racebook as well. Other options this weekend, Martell's Grill and Bar at the Colony Golf Course, Oaks and Derby Day, the Betmobile there, and the Bet Bus will be out at Chris's Mid-City Tavern in Menance on Kentucky Derby Day Saturday. Don't forget, with the early post times tomorrow here on the network, we kick off a little bit early, 8 a.m. for the Handicappers Report tomorrow, 9 a.m. for Racing Across America. So 8 Handicapper Support, 9 for Racing Across America tomorrow. And the same early start, 8 and 9 for the programs Saturday morning as well. So set the alarm to wake up a little early. And in fact, you can set the alarm even earlier because we're about to tape a Derby seminar, you know, a virtual seminar. Usually we have it down at the Clubhouse Racebook prior to the first Saturday in May. This year we're going to do it here on the set and plug it in 7 a.m. tomorrow and Saturday. But you'll also be able to find it probably a little bit later today, appearing on the Capital OTB YouTube channel. So keep that in mind as well, the Kentucky Derby, virtual Kentucky Derby seminar. All right, I'm going to wrap it up for Racing Across America for this Thursday morning. Thanks for joining us. Enjoy the racing this afternoon. And don't forget, early start tomorrow here on the network, 7 a.m. for the Derby seminar, 8 a.m. for the Handicapper Support. We'll see you then.
Across America with Seth Merrow. Racing Across America has been brought to you by CapitalOTBBet.com, the premier online wagering site in New York State. CapitalOTBBet.com. Sign up today. The Leah Auto Group. To search their inventory, schedule a service appointment, or find a dealership near you, visit LeahCars.com. Leah Cars for life. And the new Capital OTB mobile app. Wager anytime, anywhere. Download it free from the iTunes Store or Google Play.